Today is May 19th, 2020. I'm Zachary Elwood, and this is the People Who Read People podcast, where I interview people from different fields about their work in understanding human behavior. Today, I'll be talking to Dr. Rob Tarswell. Dr. Tarswell is dual certified in psychiatry and nuclear medicine. He's the chief medical officer of Initio Medical Imaging, a PET CT clinic, and he consults on complex cases where traumatic brain injury and psychiatric syndromes may both be present. His scientific research has included the use of psychotherapy for medically unexplained symptoms, measurable brain changes associated with psychodynamic psychotherapies, and the use of functional brain imaging in psychiatric disorders. He's a clinical assistant professor on the Faculty of Medicine at the University of British Columbia. Welcome to the program, Dr. Tarswell.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, very, very honored to have you on. I'm going to talk about some interesting brain imaging stuff today and your work. So first, we'll talk about your traumatic brain injury work. And I should start that out with saying in 2015, Discover Magazine selected your research as one of the top 100 science stories for 2015.
Yeah, that was nice. We were sandwiched right in between the Tesla Powerwall and Pluto, either getting demoted or re-promoted in planetary status. It's always moving up and down.
You were pretty high up there. You were like on, was it like number 19 or something like that, right?
15, I think.
15,
but
okay.
It's been 5 years now, so I'd have to go digging back to see for sure where we landed on the list. We were pretty pleased.
So let's talk about that. Like, what was the goal there, and what was the problem you were trying to solve with that?
Right. That research? So the core question was, how can you differentiate post-traumatic stress disorder from traumatic brain injury? And post-traumatic stress disorder is a trauma-related disorder. So somebody experiences a traumatic event that's often either involving serious injury or the risk or threat of serious injury or death, or some kind of severe invalidation like a rape. And traumatic brain injury, which is a little more self-explanatory, that's either a direct impact on the head or an indirect impact, such as a concussive wave from an explosion or a significant flexion extension injury of the neck. And there can be a lot of symptom overlap between these two. So individuals with both disorders will report trouble sleeping. They'll report difficulty with memory. They'll report irritability and explosive temper. They'll report poor impulse control. So as physicians, we want to understand, all right, is this one or is it the other, or is it maybe a mix of both? Because the treatments are different. Some of the treatments for post-traumatic stress disorder, such as sedative medication like benzodiazepines, would be relatively contraindicated in traumatic brain injury because they can lead to paradoxical amplification of aggressive impulses and acting out. So it's worthwhile to try and understand the difference. And we wondered whether functional brain imaging might help tip the scale and improve the diagnostic precision of just standard paper and pencil tests and diagnostic interviews.
And this would be especially meaningful to find out for patients or people who have had both traumatic physical experiences and traumatic emotional experiences, right? That was one of the areas of confusion. Like, so for soldiers, for example, that's one of the use cases.
Right. Yeah. So a paradigm case would be, you aren't the person who's standing right beside the improvised explosive device. You're the person who's maybe 90 meters away and you see members of your platoon cut into shreds, but you also get knocked back 10 or 20 meters and have an intense headache for the next 3 days. So very worthwhile to know whether you've had psychological traumatization from that and physical traumatization through that concussive force.
Right. Can I ask first, is that also the reason to choose something like that, is that you're choosing something that's very physical versus something that's, you know, very emotional. So it's the, was that also a factor in doing that research to be able to make a, have such a clear delineation? Is that accurate?
Well, it turns out that we did end up having a fairly clear delineation. And part of the reason for that could be that in traumatic brain injury generally, neurons that have been physically traumatized tend to, because of internal derangements within the neurons, aren't able to metabolize efficiently or at a normal rate. And so the brain, just to kind of link this with our imaging method, brain cells that are working hard are burning up sugar, and burning up sugar creates carbon dioxide, and carbon dioxide causes blood vessels to dilate, which brings in more blood. And our imaging method measures blood flow. So it doesn't measure brain metabolism directly. There are other methods that do directly measure metabolism. So we're indirectly measuring metabolism through demand. Neurons that are burning high are recruiting a lot of blood. Neurons that are just kind of humming along normally would have sort of within a normal range. And then neurons that are struggling or under metabolizing for whatever reason are going to recruit less blood flow. And we can take that spectrum of blood flow and create 3D maps essentially of brain perfusion. And our interest was in, because traumatic brain injury, there's a derangement of function. So there's decreased metabolism versus post-traumatic stress disorder, which tends to be a hyperactivation of portions of the brain involved in emotional circuitry or production of emotions, in particular anxiety, which is sort of the core emotion of post-traumatic stress disorder. And so there's hyperactivation in what we call the limbic circuit. So structures deep in the center of the brain, the thalamus, the basal ganglia. The thalamus is the big switching station that sits on top of the brainstem, and it communicates between the rest of the body via the spinal cord and the cerebral cortex, which is the part of your brain that thinks, which sits on the outside of your brain. The vast majority of your brain, like 90%+ is white matter. And that's basically just all the cables connecting the server boxes. So most of your brain is cables, and the servers are just way out on the outside. So the nice thing is traumatic brain injury tends to cause decreases in activity in the cortex, which is on the outside, whereas post-traumatic stress disorder causes increased metabolism in functions, or pardon me, in structures near the center of your brain. So we thought...
So was that known going in before the research, or was that...
Well, based on our review article that we published in 2014, based on a 2-year review, we were pretty satisfied that with our imaging method, brain perfusion SPECT, decreased activity either focally or globally, depending on the severity of the traumatic brain injury, is the neurobiological finding or the imaging finding. And there was also, to a lesser extent, evidence supporting increased activation, therefore hypermetabolism, hyperperfusion in anxiety states in limbic structures near the center of the brain. So we had what we thought would be nice, easily separable neurobiological phenomenon to interrogate a clinical phenomenon, which is much harder to tease apart. So this seemed to be, if there's a low-hanging fruit of neurobiology in a clinical setting, this is it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, and you pulled those, your work involved reviewing images from an existing library database of many images over the years. Is that right?
That's right. So the images we use came from the Amen database, and that's a database of approximately, I think now, about 130,000 brain perfusion SPECT scans performed by the same technologists using the same technique on the same cameras over a number of years. These scans in this database go back to the early 90s. So It's almost a 30-year-old database of scans, but because the cameras are the same and the software is the same, a scan performed in 1995 is going to be comparable in quality and data validity to a scan performed in 2015. And scans are performed in two conditions. One, the individual is at rest, and the other one, the individual is engaged in a concentration task, which is the Connors continuous performance task used to diagnose ADHD. And it's a laptop-based task. You're basically watching a screen and hitting the space bar whenever you see certain conditions. So we had about 20,000 individuals that we had. So some of these were individuals with pure post-traumatic stress disorder, some pure traumatic brain injury, some post-traumatic stress disorder plus traumatic brain injury together, and then all three of those plus extra conditions. So maybe alcohol use disorder, mood disorders, other substance use disorders.
And then I assume a control, there would be a control group of just healthy people too, I guess.
Yeah, the AIMN database also has about 100 brains, or 100 scans, I should say, from across the age span, at concentration and at rest, in individuals with no history of substance use disorder, no history of psychiatric disorders, no history of brain infections, and no history of head injuries. So the, you could say, sort of the unicorns of life who volunteered to allow study of their brains in this normal state. And
but
our
I guess
data,
for your for your purposes though, you were mainly focused on differentiating the two brains or the two conditions, not necessarily the healthy scans.
Right.
Is that
but
right?
The process was, all right, can we distinguish traumatic brain injury from a normal brain? Can we distinguish post-traumatic stress disorder in our data set from normal? Can we distinguish PTSD plus TBI from normal? Can we distinguish PTSD from TBI? Can we distinguish PTSD or TBI from the combination of PTSD and TBI? And the answer to all those questions was yes. In particular, we had very high accuracy distinguishing PTSD, TBI, or the combination from the normal data set. Accuracy basically of 100%, which you should always be suspicious of. Anytime you find accuracy of 100%, you think, okay, what have we done wrong? Because this isn't how
too
the
easy.
World works. Too easy. Yeah. Too easy. Yeah, wrap it up. Right. We're done here. we're heading to Stockholm. But what we did was then, well, okay, so that's fine. How about if we take, can we distinguish PTSD not only from normal, but from TBI brains? Yes. How about brains with PTSD and TBI? Yes. Okay. How about from brains with PTSD, TBI, alcohol use disorder, and major depression? Yes. But importantly, as we stress tested the data by taking our pure samples versus samples with more and more burden of illness, the accuracy went down, which is exactly what you would expect, because this is going to be more difficult for a human reader to distinguish. It was also more difficult for our statistical method to distinguish, because, say, traumatic brain injury, which has decreased brain activity, a lot of substance use disorders also have decreased brain activity. So if someone has post-traumatic stress disorder and alcohol use disorder, one's dialing up the brain, the other one's dialing down the brain. So we would expect there to be difficulties in distinguishing that from, say, a pure PTSD. And sure enough, we did find those difficulties. But even under maximum sort of stress test conditions, the accuracy of our testing, by which I mean the ability to distinguish true positives and true negatives from the entire data set, remained about 65%. So clinically relevant accuracy, even under pretty significant stress test kind of conditions.
What are the practical benefits of this? Like, would this mean somebody would be able to go in and know objectively at a pretty high reliability level what they were suffering from.
So the clinical benefit is, if we kind of circle back to that difficulty because of the high symptom overlap, there could be individuals out there who have traumatic brain injury in addition to PTSD, and they're not responding to standard PTSD treatments. Maybe they're not doing well with psychotherapy. Maybe they're not doing well with medications. And maybe there's some lack of clarity around the diagnosis. So in this case, this test could indicate to a treating physician, well, look, you know, there's a comorbid traumatic brain injury here. Maybe we need to not be pushing so hard for substantial remission or a cure. Maybe we're looking at a completely different prognostic trajectory, and maybe we need to help this individual get onto some disability program and look at longer term rehabilitation instead of just operating under the assumption that, gee, you should be better by now. You're getting the best treatments, right? So it can be really validating for patients. It can be a source of relief for patients and families, for care providers. Because people, by and large, they want to know what happened to them. What's going on inside my brain? And just simply having an accurate diagnosis itself can be really therapeutic, especially if there's been a lot of frustration therapeutically. It also can end up becoming important medical legally, say, before the courts when trying to determine the true extent of injuries, and therefore trying to determine long-term prognosis. In particular, the court is interested in, all right, what's the functional impact of this down the road, and how do we offset that loss of function with appropriate funding to make sure that this person's care needs are taken care of and that there's appropriate compensation for lost income.
I might be missing something obvious, but it seems like this is, I'm just surprised no one had done that work before, because it seems like were they doing scans, imaging of brains to determine injury before, but just no one had compared it with other types of scans? Is it just that simple? Because it seems like
it kind of
it seems like they would have been. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, it gets into sort of the strange history of functional brain imaging. And in the early 70s, the number one brain imaging modality in the world was brain perfusion SPECT. And you're like, what? What are you talking about? I've never heard about this before 2 weeks ago. And what ended up happening at that time was the brain perfusion tracers that were approved for acute stroke. This is in an era when CT scanning didn't exist yet. And the only way to detect stroke was clinically. Somebody comes in and their face is asymmetrical, their speech is slurred, their arm is weak. Okay, that's a stroke. One question that's of interest medically, though, is, all right, is this an ischemic stroke or a hemorrhagic stroke? Because if it's a stroke from a bleed, we need to wake up a neurosurgeon and drain out that blood. Whereas if it's an ischemic stroke, you know, from the 1970s perspective, well, that's too bad, but, you know, we don't have to wake up a neurosurgeon. And so the first imaging method that was able to spot stroke and maybe indicate some of these differences were these brain perfusion tracers. So there'd just basically be this big dark spot where the tracer couldn't go, because it would either be blocked by the blocked blood vessel or blocked by all the pressure generated from the internal bleed that was squeezing blood vessels and not allowing blood to be delivered to a particular area in the brain. By the early 80s, CT scanning came along and quite rapidly and appropriately displaced SPECT, because now CT scans can give us information about, all right, the skull, the scalp, the brain tissue itself. And their CTs are brilliant at differentiating the type of stroke. And then by the mid to late 90s, now we're looking at treatments for acute stroke. So we're going to use clot busters in ischemic stroke. We're going to use neurosurgery in hemorrhagic stroke. And at the same time, PET as an imaging modality was arising, particularly in United States academic medical centers. And PET at that time had superior spatial resolution to SPECT, And all crucially, in the mid-90s, CMS under Medicare approved a fee code for the use of PET in the workup of cancer, because PET uses a molecule called FDG, which is radioactive sugar, basically, that directly measures metabolism. And a lot of cancers are very hypermetabolic. They're very hungry for sugar. They take up FDG and glow like Christmas lights on these scans. And physicians and scientists realize, oh, wow, this is really important information to help us properly stage cancer for who needs surgery versus those in whom it's too late. And PET was the first imaging modality that allowed this kind of major shift in cancer staging and therefore cancer treatment. So a fee code came for PET, and all the dust covers got thrown on all the SPECT machines used for brain, and all of academic attention got shifted to the use of PET for brain imaging in addition to cancer imaging. It became sort of the bell of the ball. And that's sort of the mid-90s picture. Fast forward another 10 years, and the new kid on the block is fMRI. And nowadays, the vast majority, I would have to say more than 90% of functional brain imaging research is functional MRI. And that is perfectly fine. That's perfectly appropriate. fMRI doesn't involve ionizing radiation. You can do it as many times as you want. But each one of these methods has its problems. So SPECT doesn't have the greatest spatial resolution. So a voxel or a volume element in a SPECT image is about seven millimeters. So we're looking at little cubes of brain that are about 7 by 7 by 7 millimeters. All right, not so great. We get down to PET, and now we're looking at about a 4 millimeter by 4 by 4 voxel. And then we compare that with fMRI. Well, structural MRI is about a 1 millimeter voxel. The functional part of MRI is actually pretty comparable to PET, about a 4 millimeter voxel superimposed on a 1 millimeter voxel.
And we should say voxels are just a word for the lowest resolution you can get for whatever.
That's right.
Whatever.
Yeah, volume element is volume basically, it's a 3D pixel. The trade-offs are that whereas SPECT has a really high signal-to-noise ratio, fMRI has a very low signal-to-noise ratio. And in a lot of university centers, there's still movement toward broad standardization of fMRI methods and software, whereas SPECT, because it was driven clinically, has had standardization of methods and techniques for almost 40 years. So there are just simply trade-offs either way. And there are a lot of individuals who can't tolerate being in an MRI scanner, particularly individuals who are prone to anxiety. It can be a claustrophobic experience, particularly if you're wearing that coil on your head and having to hold still, and that thing is pounding like a German disco.
And you have to be in there for a while. Is that true?
That's getting better. I think fMRI, in terms of its speed, is getting faster and faster. But you're in there, you're close. It can be up to 40 minutes, 45 minutes. Inspect, we can kind of get the scan done in about 15 minutes. We don't have to do the scan right away. You know, when I inject that tracer into you, within about 2 to 5 minutes, it is distributed into your neurons, and it stays locked in that distribution because your blood carries the tracer to the neuron. It passes freely into the neuron through the cell membrane, and then it gets chemically ionized in the neuron and therefore is trapped in the cytosol, which is the sort of the goopy jelly fluid component of the cell. And so it doesn't diffuse back across the membrane. So it's like a Polaroid, and that Polaroid persists for up to 6 hours. So what we can do in individuals with a SPECT scan is, all right, we're going to inject you. And once that tracer has equilibrated or reached equilibrium, all right, now we can give you a sedative if you have claustrophobia. we can wait for that sedative to work. And then we can take the images. There's just no rush. Whereas if I was to give you a sedative for an MRI, for an fMRI scan, it's going to directly affect the activation patterns in your brain precisely when I'm trying to interrogate certain kinds of activation patterns. But again,
because the fMRI it doesn't involve any ingestion of stuff. It's just measuring blood flow. Is that right?
That's correct. So it's looking at the ratio between oxygenated and deoxygenated hemoglobin, because those have slightly different interactions in a magnetic field.
Okay. I had a question about this. So for the SPECT, it wasn't clear if it was just, you had said pictures. So it's taking multiple pictures. I was wondering why it required multiple pictures and not just one.
Well, it's, think of it, there's a, say there's a source of radioactivity inside your brain. And if I have a single plate, I'm going to capture an image of that radioactivity, and I'll know where it is in two-dimensional space on that plate, right? Mm-hmm. But if I want to make a 3D image of where that radioactivity is, I got to kind of move that plate. And so it rotates around your brain, and then we capture more radioactivity. And now we have... because of where the activity is on the plates, we can just draw lines, straight lines back to the brain, and where they cross, that's where the activity came from.
So that's the, so basically you're triangulating, and that's what the tomography part of the,
that's the tomography part, right.
It's basically putting it together, taking the two-dimensional pictures and making a three-dimensional object out of it.
Exactly.
Is that correct?
Yeah. Okay.
So for the fMRI, I'm not clear there either. What does it take? What does that one take so long? Because that one seems like it's more clearly like you can get a 3D image easier. So I wasn't sure how that exactly worked, and maybe we're getting too far off, but I was really interested in that, how that fMRI worked.
Yeah. Great questions. They just happen to be sort of outside my arena.
Okay.
So
okay,
I don't know MRI physics, so I'm not going
to.
We
were getting too far away from our subject matter. Anyway, let's get back to, when you talked about being able to recognize all of those indicators successfully, was that surprising to you? And, or did you expect, based on your understanding, to see that?
We expected that, so it was gratifying that that hypothesis worked out. I think a lot of science is just kind of progressive heartbreak when study after study just doesn't work out, doesn't go your way. In this case, it was really nice to get a nice brisk result, and I think that was a product of choosing something carefully. In an area that where separately these areas had been highly investigated, and it was the right confluence. Somebody, wow, this chocolate is really good. And then over here in the literature, it's like, wow, this peanut butter is really good. And then it's like, happens if we combine chocolate and peanut butter? Can we
get that gets Reese's? Me back. That gets me back to the question I wanted to ask was, you chose SPECT because you had such a database. Is that correct? Like, I was going to ask why you didn't choose fMRI.
Right. Well, it's sort of like kind of looking where you are in a sense. My background's nuclear medicine. I was working with nuclear medicine colleagues and psychiatric colleagues who are just happen to be interested in this particular modality in psychiatric disorders. And therefore, we just thought, okay, well, what do we got? What do we got here? And we happen to have that database. And so the study more or less came together over about an 18 month period. Our study leader was a really, really dynamic neuroradiological investigator, Dr. Cyrus Radji, who's now a neuroradiologist in St. Louis. St. Louis? I don't know how you pronounce St. Louis, Missouri. At Washington University anyway. But at the time he was a radiology resident at UCLA who had a background, a PhD in neuroscience, looking specifically at manipulation of large neuroimaging data sets. So we just happened to find the right guy who got interested in these questions, and we were off. Mm-hmm.
So does that mean if you were able to recognize indicators of PTSD, does that mean, would that be very similar to indicators of depression or other, you know, psychological, emotional problems? Are those
right?
Those
so, I mean, yeah. So, I mean, the nice thing about, say, this study is the typically, you know, individuals know if they're in some kind of psychiatric distress, and they either, I mean, they may have varying degrees of insight into that. They may, you know, resist wanting to kind of look at those aspects of their lives. But generally speaking, these are individuals who were seeking help for psychiatric difficulties. This is how they ended up coming to clinical attention in the first place. So essentially, you could use SPECT to interrogate other psychiatric disorders. And that's an area of research that I've kind of progressed to now. This is a question of interest to me. You know, what can SPECT tell us about the search for biomarkers in mood disorders, for instance? And I'm working with a young psychiatry resident, Dr. Joel Fox, and using deep learning networks to take, again, a big chunk of data from the Amen database, this time around 11,000 cases, and use different kinds of machine learning, deep learning algorithms to interrogate. And those studies are ongoing, and we're looking forward to what kind of gets spit out of the machine. But potentially, yeah, you could use SPECT and this database if you wanted. You could investigate psychotic disorders, mood disorders, substance use disorders. There's nothing that would particularly prevent that. My hunch is that as we move further and further away from the low-hanging fruit, it's going to be more and more difficult to make the distinctions. And because of, we might run up against the limitations of SPECT because of its relatively low spatial resolution and the limitations of brain perfusion, which is kind of a non-specific approach, right? So in PET, we can basically make just about any small molecule. I mean, we're not just limited to making FDG. So we can make dopamine with a SPECT scanner, for a PET scanner. We can make serotonin. We can make analogs of these compounds. And we can get into looking at very precise metabolic targets. So we can look at specific proteins. So you maybe have heard of amyloid, which is the main protein abnormality in Alzheimer's disease, or tau, which is the main protein abnormality in chronic traumatic encephalopathy. PET allows us to do those things. SPECT is more limited simply because of the kinds of molecules that we have to work with, as our radioactive emitters in SPECT are much more limited than what we can work with in PET. We can use fundamental building blocks of biomolecules. So in PET, you can use carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine to make small molecules, whereas in SPECT, you're more or less limited to using an atom called technetium, which is a breakdown product of molybdenum. And now you're stuck with the chemical constraints of having to use a fairly large metallic ion and having to link it to a molecule that targets a process of interest. That might be getting a little technical. It's suddenly occurring to me.
So you might have explained this and I just missed it, but why can't you use fMRI for this, for the work you're doing?
I think potentially you could. Again, I'm just not familiar enough with the fMRI literature. So this study, it might be out there. It might have been published. This is the terrible world of science. Even people who are literally using functional brain imaging techniques to investigate the very same diseases, there's now just so much specialized knowledge that we're almost completely siloed off from each other.
Right. I mean, it just seems tremendously complex. I mean, it just makes you think of, it makes me think of the you know, trying to govern a country these days is just so tremendously complex with how many issues you have to deal with. And just the same kind of idea. I mean, it's just, there's, the landscape is just so large, you know.
Right.
Amazing.
So if that fMRI investigator is out there and listening to this podcast, get a hold of Zachary, because I would love to hear what you have to say.
maybe I'll do some Googling. But yeah, I mean, I hear what you're saying. It's like, I mean, I tried to do some research for this interview, and it's just so much stuff, and I can't, you know, I don't have obviously, you know, enough time to even learn a fraction of what's out there.
Right.
So much stuff. Let's see. So let's talk a little bit about the psychodynamic therapy work you've done. What was the gist of that work?
So we were interested there in functional brain imaging and psychodynamic psychotherapy. So to back up a bit, psychodynamic psychotherapy is an outgrowth of psychoanalytic approaches. So that's what we would call sort of depth psychology. So this is the theory of mind that posits that we not only have a conscious mind, but also an unconscious mind. And we have, there are aspects of our mind that are obviously unconscious. So for instance, I know that I open my eyes and I see, but I have literally no access to how I see. It simply happens. So there's all this unconscious processing going on, and I open my eyes and there's just a picture of the world, and I couldn't tell you how or why that happens. So
is it accurate to say that that's the psychodynamic aspect is what Freud and his, you know, the people around that time were popularizing, that kind of theory of the mind? Is that accurate?
Yeah. And well, what makes something psychodynamically interesting is that it's not simply unconscious, but efforts to make it conscious are possible, A, but are B, resisted. And so there's this barrier between the psychodynamic unconscious, or the dynamic unconscious for short, and conscious awareness that's put up by resistance. So for instance, Freud gave this great example of somebody who is writing a novel, and every time they tried to type the word mother, the word murder would get typed out. And so Freud surmised, well, perhaps you have some kind of murderous wish toward your mother. Oh, no, no, Dr. Freud. No, no, no.
You're right. I love her very much.
Yeah, I love her very much. Yeah.
So would that be also the idea there with those psychodynamic theories of mind is the idea that clearing up, making conscious the associations, the subconscious thoughts is part of the process of healing. That's part of the idea of doing the therapy, is making those things conscious. Is that accurate?
Right. So to the degree possible, bringing these forbidden or feared unconscious desires, wishes, fantasies into conscious mind for examination and reprocessing, and essentially just
integration,
taking the power out of them, right? And so Freud was a wonderfully kind of wry and melancholy figure, and he thought that he had pretty humble goals for psychoanalysis. He said he just wanted to replace neurotic misery with ordinary unhappiness.
Right, that is a noble goal, and doesn't sound too idealistic.
No. And interestingly, in Freud, his background was neurology. And in the 1890s, he published some interesting work on aphasia. Particularly, he was interested in the neuroanatomy of aphasia, which was a really hot topic because it had been discovered that small strokes in particular areas of the brain have been discovered by two prior scientists, Broca and Wernicke, that strokes in one particular area of the brain led to the ability to speak, but a complete loss of the ability to comprehend. A stroke in another part of the brain led to perfect understanding of speech, but a complete loss of the ability to speak. And so this was fascinating to Freud. And Freud was also wondering about really a neuroscience of psychological phenomena, and he embarked around 1895 on the project for a scientific psychology. And he had this really interesting theory, a kind of a hydraulic theory, where this kind of mental fluid is kind of hydraulically pushed through different parts of the brain. And he pretty quickly realized that we're just not close at all in our understanding of neuroscience. And so that's when he switched to a metaphorical approach. And that's when he began to develop his theory of mind, his kind of geographic model and his topographic model, basically consisting of the conscious, the preconscious, the unconscious, and then the superego, the ego, and the id, and their interactions are what lead to mental life.
Metaphorically hydraulic, in the sense like you push something down, you repress something, and it pops up somewhere else, and you have other symptoms that.
And he thought initially that it would be really difficult to try and understand the unconscious of a patient, but he realized that, you know, I think he said the unconscious, it leaks out everywhere in murmurs and facial expressions and twitches and ringing of the hands.
Oh, I thought his psychopathology of everyday life is one of the things that inspired me to, you know, be interested in behavior and get into poker tells. You know, I read that as a kid and really influenced me. I just thought it was a great perceptive book, you know.
It's fascinating stuff. It's absolutely fascinating. The guy was... I mean, he was a bit high on his own supply, and I don't just mean the cocaine. But
both ways.
He had some like seriously legitimate and profound insights, and even his approach to clinical practice was really revolutionary. He was the first person that said, "Okay, like the doors are shut. What you tell me stays with me, and you can say anything you want." And in Victorian Europe, this is an extremely revolutionary idea.
Right. People are so buttoned up, so repressed, and to be able to get those things off their chest would be huge.
Yeah, and so when he would start an analysis, there were basically only it was really only one rule, two rules: say whatever comes to your mind and don't censor yourself. And inevitably, somebody would start talking, and within about 30 to 45 seconds, they'd stop, right? So, okay, the resistance is here and we're off. And he tried to develop sort of passive techniques to overcome the resistance. Psychodynamic approaches, to kind of circle back, is the involvement of more direct confrontation with resistance to try and get at the unconscious gold. And lead to healing. And we were interested in the question of, all right, well, who's been doing research in this area? It turns out there's a real hotbed of it, of PET research in psychoanalysis and psychodynamic theory in Finland, of all places, in the 90s. This was a real hot topic. Somebody, I guess, just must have got a massive grant back in the day. And we brought together a group looking at, all right, let's look at PET, let's look at SPECT, let's look at fMRI, because we had an fMRI researcher who was also in training as a clinical psychologist and was interested in psychodynamic psychotherapy. And so we spent about a year and a half gathering all the data and found, you know, the findings are kind of interesting, that individuals in states of psychiatric distress, whether that's discrete psychiatric disorders like a mood disorder or say a personality disorder, they have differences from say normal population brain studies. And over a course of psychodynamic therapy, as an individual improves clinically, their brains tend to come to resemble the brain scans from a normal population.
Wow. That's great.
Yeah. So that this would have been, I think, this is kind of one of these days where you sort of wish that Freud was alive. Yeah. And you could sort of take him into the control room of the scanner and say, look.
Right. No, that's amazing.
In 1895, you know, you were a century too early with your idea.
He'd be smiling down.
Yeah, we're directly visualizing it now.
I mean, that's amazing, and it's amazing to me. I mean, you would think therapists would be maybe they're more classy than that, but you think they'd be plastering that all over their advertisements at this point? You know, it's like that's pretty amazing.
Yeah, I think though, if we sort of there was this period where when we started to first study brain function, there kind of got to be this sort of profligate tendency to talk about the brain change of anything. And there would be, you know, articles like learning a second language changes your brain, smelling a flower changes your brain. And I think the thing we came to realize is, well, you know, your brain is the thing that processes the world, and it's constantly changing. It is the organ whose job is to adapt to the world, and adaptation is change. Mm-hmm. So everything is changing your brain constantly. And I think finally we're kind of moving away from that sort of golly, wow, look, this changes your brain,
right.
To more of like, okay, well, what's changing and how do we put together the deeper hypothesis about fundamental brain function. And that's kind of really the really interesting stuff in the last 10 years, getting into brain network theory, which that's probably taken us again. We're heading off the path.
Oh, I don't mind. It's all interesting to me. I kind of treat this as just things I'm interested in. So I definitely don't mind.
Okay. Oh, very good. Yeah, yeah. Very good. Yeah. Yeah.
That's one way to constrain the scope of the podcast, is just things I'm interested in.
Well, it constrains it in a very lovely way too.
Yeah, it's yeah. You know, people listening is a bonus.
But the way to kind of wrap that back around is the reason that I think therapists aren't talking of, and there was a period where therapists would talk about brain changes of this and that, but fundamentally, people aren't going to therapists to change their brains. They're going to feel better or to perform better or behave better, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. They're like, look, I don't care, my brain, this, that, whatever. I just hate being depressed. Mm-hmm. Just fix me.
So, do you think the, you know, when it comes to trying to measure and interpret the brains of people with psychological, emotional problems, mm-hmm. it seems like one of the major obstacles is the prescription of drugs, because, you know, that really throws a wrench in the works in trying to determine, you know, what's changed over time. Like, has therapy yeah. changed people, or has the drug prescription, et cetera, et cetera. Do you have any thoughts on that? Has that come up in your work, that problem?
Hasn't come up specifically in my research, but definitely a very active field of research is the neurobiological impact of medication. So, you know, believe it or not, it wasn't really only until the mid-60s that Arvid Carlson, to the shock of everyone around the world, discovered that there's dopamine in the brain. And these days we're like, well, duh, right? But there was a time when that wasn't known. And so the first question is, well, why is there dopamine in the brain? Or in the 1950s, why is this medication that we're giving to treat patients with tuberculosis making them all so happy? Mm. And pharmacology or neuropharmacology has kind of been this interesting side development, side by side with progress in psychotherapy, progress in fundamental understanding of the brain. And to me, what's interesting is that the way that psychotherapy changes the brain is different from the way that medication changes the brain. But what's interesting clinically is the outcome is the same. And maybe the analogy there goes back to traumatic brain injury versus post-traumatic stress disorder. TBI can lead to high-level behavioral changes that are very similar to post-traumatic stress disorder, even though neurobiologically the picture is very different. And so what I take from that is that the brain on the whole is constantly, dynamically generating our internal picture of the world to ourselves, mm-hmm. and generating our behavior in a way where the sound that the orchestra makes is similar enough that even though these two orchestras have quite different composition instrumentally, the sum of the sound made by the two orchestras can be difficult to tease apart. So the brain works with what it has to generate what it can.
When you did that work for the Finland work, that was just reviewing a lot of studies. Was that correct?
That's right. That was a literature review, which we were surprised hadn't been done before. So that was nice. It's nice to be able to kind of look at a field of disparate studies across different modalities and find, in a sense, that a lot of these studies are seeing with one eye, even though they're from communities that typically aren't talking together. And that's one thing I really like about review work, is it's the opportunity for that interdisciplinary interface to happen. So maybe at some point, perhaps in my years of leisure, should they ever occur, I'll take a look at the PTSD versus TBI question from a broad review framework again, but also fold in the PET literature and fold in the fMRI literature. My God, the spec review nearly killed me. So
sounds like I was gonna say, it sounds like a life's work, you know.
Yeah, just like, keeping up. Yeah, just yeah. keeping up.
Mm. So many areas. I mean, what about would it be possible, currently possible, or possible in the future, for an insurance company wanted to get a brain scan of someone to find out if they were malingering or something? Is that feasible, or is there some ethical problem with that?
Well, that kind of comes back to the orchestra issue. Malingering, typically, that's sort of the conscious production of symptoms, usually to achieve some sort of gain, often a financial gain, or to escape an obligation like work or school. Mom, my tummy hurts. And of course, it's of interest to the courts, right? And wouldn't it be great if we could find, aha, here's the brain region for malingering. But what we're discovering is that because behavior is the end product of the interactions of multiple networks, and that networks themselves have compensatory strategies, and meta-networks have compensatory strategies, to the point where, say, if you're 10 years old and you have refractory seizures, neurosurgeons can take out half your brain and you will essentially grow up normally, with maybe very subtle asymmetric clumsiness that a skilled clinician would be able to detect. But it's rare, but it definitely happens that in really severe refractory seizures, they can't localize them. They'll remove up to half your brain. And this has to be done prior to a certain age. So that person who presents and lives a completely normal life will have an absolutely abnormal brain scan, right?
Right?
So the idea of brain scanning to detect a phenomenon as complex as malingering, because you have to think about that, right? This involves conscious intention, conscious fakery.
Well, I was thinking more about like the lack of a traumatic brain injury, for example.
Right.
Proving the lack of it, but maybe you're talking about that too.
Well, certainly, you know, our scans can exclude traumatic brain injury, they can't exclude somebody who has become, has a strong psychological reaction to the fact that they've had a head injury and they're suddenly, they're not able to.
Yeah, it's a gray area.
Yeah. And they're having a struggle confronting the fact that, I'm not immortal. I'm vulnerable and the world is scary and dangerous. And I shouldn't get out of bed, right? A lot of people might go, ever since he had that traumatic brain injury, he just hasn't been able to get out of bed. Well, maybe, but there could be a lot of reasons for that, right?
And this is what makes psychiatry existential. Yeah.
Yeah. And this is what makes psychiatry an endlessly fascinating subject.
Right. Yeah. I mean, in short, the brain is so complex that we would be unlikely to figure out all the reasons why someone's behaving a certain way to narrow it down that. Exactly.
And this is why, you know, companies that advertise that they can detect lies in brain scans just really grind my gears, because that is just
right.
That's horseshit.
Yeah, you're skeptical about a lot of that, and that's one of the. I wanted to have someone on, what was his name now? Dr. Marcel Just, okay. who had done, you know, he had done that work on the, you know, recognizing like the pattern, using fMRI to recognize the pattern for certain words or okay. or phrases in the brain. And I want to have him on, and he said he'd be on later. So I'll talk to him about that. But yeah, I know you had been, you had talked about, you know, being skeptical about some of that work and not his work necessarily, but just, you know, scans in general, because you thought there was a lot of like overstating of the what was possible.
Well, yeah, what it often ends up happening is somebody say, well, we'll do some kind of work and they'll be able to kind of produce some findings in a discrete domain. But then what ends up happening is other individuals may seize upon that and want to rush to commercial applications, right? So, and this is a constant threat in science, is the rush to commercialization. I mean, who doesn't want to land the big patent, right?
Easy answers.
Absolutely. Yeah. but the problem is, it's very, very easy in this field to get way out over your skis. And, you know, we're not skiing down this mountain, we're actually just falling and tumbling down this mountain. We don't have a clue what we're talking about, but we can easily kind of misrepresent our findings. So yeah, that's not unique to brain science, although there seems to be a razzle dazzle factor when it comes to brain scientists, where people might be uniquely susceptible to the claims of brain science. And this is an interesting bit of psychological literature. If you take a psychological paper and you add color images of brains to it, it's generally more believed and is generally thought to be more scientific and more accurate. Absolutely
interesting. Wow, they've actually studied that, you're saying?
Yes.
Wow, okay. Well, that's interesting.
We who work in brain science are no exception, right? So when I'm flipping through a journal, I'll linger over a really nice looking brain image and the caption and be, oh, I wonder what this is all about.
Well, it's definitely sexy. It's kind of like makes you think of, you know, rocket scientists and brain surgeons. It's like we just automatically are, you know, it's sexy and very complicated lines of work. And maybe you're right. We just automatically defer to anything having to do with brains or rocket science. Maybe that's why we respect Elon Musk so much, even though he gets a little weird.
Yeah. That guy, he's even kind of got a brain stimulation thing going on, doesn't he? Or he's trying to get it off the ground. We don't hear
much really?
About it.
Oh, really? No, I haven't heard about that.
Yeah. He's got I think he's trying to launch a neural stimulation company. I don't know much
about it. Oh, man. I wouldn't want him messing around in my brain. I'll tell you that.
Right? Yeah. I want the skull to stay closed unless there's like a compelling surgical indication to go in there.
That's really interesting about the brain images. That's a good tip for, you know, con artists out there to, you know, if they want to promote their faux science quackery.
Yeah. Well, you're from Oregon, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, don't put a bird on it, put a brain on it.
Yeah, and we should mention your Twitter profile has a
it's got image a big of colorful a brain, 3D
yeah, colorful
brain.
3D brain. Yeah, you're using that to your benefit, you know. So it's a good example.
Yeah, you know, exactly. Yeah.
The good guys.
Although
I'm
using my powers for
yeah. That's what I'm saying.
For
the,
good.
But, yeah, the good guys can use it too. You can use that power for good.
Yeah. Although obviously I'll have to leave that ultimate judgment to others whether this is in fact what's happening.
Right. A future study.
Right.
So if you had to say what your main, if there's been a main driver for your work, your main interests and life's, you know, goals in your profession, what has guided you in that area?
I think I am somebody who is interested in emergent phenomenon. So what the heck does that mean? Well, that's like the idea that, somehow wind on water makes waves. There's nothing intrinsic about water that causes waves to arise. It's just something that emerges when you get enough water together that waves arise. There's nothing in the physics or chemistry of water that specifically would predict a wave. Waves are consistent with water, but they have to be accounted for on their own terms. And wave equations don't have to take into account anything about water. Mm-hmm. So kind of interested...
Kind of a sum is greater than its parts kind of gestalt theory.
Yeah,
kind of
or thing. The sum, at least to our ability, somehow can't be easily reduced.
Mm. Can't be predicted.
We have, you know, so there are cases where we have great reduction. So one of the great triumphs of the 19th century thermodynamics was the absolute reduction of temperature to the average kinetic energy of atoms or molecules, right? So temperature is a phenomenon that reduces, but there are emergent phenomena that don't reduce. And one of the things that, of course, is of great interest in neuroscience is, all right, consciousness. What aspects of consciousness reduce and what aspects don't? And I think that's a really kind of, that gives us a scientific way of approaching consciousness, sort of like the approach that, say, Christoph Koch is taking that allows us, you know, I think philosophy can help us constrain the nature of mind. At least it can help us to stay away from conceptual confusions. And then careful neuroscience that's conceptually guided can say, okay, what parts can we reduce and what parts can't we reduce? And so that we don't, I think, keep getting stuck again and again and again in philosophical conversations about the nature of mind that don't sort of help us advance the conversation in a way that starts to solve problems. So one of the things that interests me initially, I think, was this, the reductive power of science. But then perhaps, you know, later on, the phenomenon of emergence or irreducible features of science. And we're kind of at this point now where I think network theory has been a massive breakthrough that's going to allow for a lot of really useful reduction in terms of mind. And we're going to, I think, mine that shaft out. Haha. And then we'll see what we're left with in terms of the new problem or the remaining problems of mind and consciousness in the next 5, 10, 20 years.
And what is network theory?
So back in the mid-2000s, when a lot of fMRI work was going on, they'd have, say, you know, college students, because there's an endless supply of college students and they all need extra credit. And if they volunteered to participate, or at least at that point, if they volunteered to participate in research studies, they get extra credits. And there were all sorts of hypotheses, and it was the early days, the Wild West of fMRI. And for any given experiment, there are going to be times when you're sitting there in the tube and there's nothing for you to do. You're not looking at pictures of horses. You're not doing mental arithmetic. You're just sitting there vegging or lying there vegging. And what some neuroscientists noticed was that, hey, you know, whenever these college kids are just vegging in the tube, their brain sort of reverts to this default state. And somebody around 2005, I might have that number wrong, published a paper about the default mode network of the brain. And they recognized that there seems to be activation in these particular areas that seems to happen when the brain is not being tasked. So that in itself, eventually people realized, hey, that in itself, that's really interesting and an important finding. And so that was, and they found that, hey, this happens in lots of people, it happens across studies, and now it's a fairly well-characterized phenomenon. And it's called the default mode network or the DMN. And on top of that, scientists began to notice that, hey, if when we present a novel stimulus in these experimental conditions, there's this brief activation of these areas that seem to switch on to assess the salience of a novel stimulus. And that became known as the salience network. And so the salience network seems to be something that kind of wakes you up out of that default mode state and orients your attention from self-reflection into either a relevant internal condition, like, say, hunger, or an external condition, like, oh, I guess the research is starting again. I see a horse on the TV screen. And then the third network that got identified was what's called now the central executive network, which is the, okay, what am I going to do about this network, in a sense. So the default mode network is the one when you are, it's kind of the autobiographical network. It's the daydreaming network. It's thinking about yourself. It could be planning about, you know, planning for the future, reminiscing about the past, but it's sort of inwardly oriented, self-oriented, and not bound or directed towards any particular stimulus, either internally or externally. Salience network lets you know, oh, there's something in the environment that requires your attention. So it suppresses activity of the default mode network. And then the central executive network is switched on. Okay, what are we going to do about this?
Right.
Do we need to do anything about
something
this?
Something is required. Yeah. Something yeah. will be required. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right.
And in 2011, the first paper came out looking at, in fMRI conditions, the interaction of these three networks. And now, like, all kinds of networks have been identified now. Hmm. These were sort of the first three in the paradigmatic cases.
Oh, wow.
Looking at network behavior in individuals with psychiatric disorders. And they found that individuals with depression tend to have an inability to deactivate the default mode network, for instance. Individuals with psychotic disorders have difficulty with deactivation of the salience network and difficulty with activation of the central executive network. And that was the first publication 9 years ago now of a network model of psychopathology. And that's kind of, yeah, so this is where neurophysiology and neuroscience is kind of going these days. In terms of being a sort of a psychiatrist on the ground, it doesn't really change what you do, right? If you're coming in depressed, I'm not going to ask you about your default mode network. I'm going to ask you about your sleep and your appetite and your ability to concentrate and all that kind of stuff, right? But looking at it now, we're sort of, and to sort of swing back to that Freud project for a scientific psychology conversation, we're now actually starting to create the building blocks to finish Freud's initial project. We're able to start to look at, all right, we can potentially start to conceive of psychiatric disorders as abnormalities of brain network functions. And what's really interesting is these days, just about everybody has a much, you know, has an intuitive grasp of what a network is. Anyone who's ever been on the internet gets the idea that my internet comes into my house from an internet service provider who's somewhere downtown, and those internet service providers have big fat pipes that talk to other computers. And when I want to do a Google search, you know, the data goes out through all these hubs and ends up somewhere in California, and some computer somewhere generates a result and boof, it pops up on my screen. So we have this intuitive understanding of networks, and the fascinating realization is this is going on in the brain, and the brain is organized in networks. And there are certain mathematical and computational techniques that can be applied specifically to networks that have now allowed us to make enormous headway into understanding at a much deeper level how the brain works. And it's kind of a fascinating time to be on the sidelines of that and to have, you know, some kind of tiny role in, you know, over in my corner doing my work. But it's this massive global effort now to really understand normal and abnormal behavior and psychological function, but from this kind of neuroscience perspective that's somewhere in between. It's like a layer in between neurobiology and kind of manifest behavior at an individual level.
Mm-hmm. Do they do any are they able to do anything right now where, say, somebody came in off the streets to a, you know, admitted to a mental hospital and they don't know anything about what's wrong with them and it can be hard to diagnose? Are they able to do anything now where they would do a brain scan and try to figure out something like that, or is that far in the future?
That's pretty far in the future. I mean, the reasons we would do a brain scan now would be, all right, you know, if somebody's coming in and they're comatose, oh, have they had a stroke? So it tends to be sort of very pretty straightforward reasons why anybody might get a scan, whether or not network theory existed. But we're nowhere close to being able to do that. There is some PET work looking at individuals in what are called locked-in states or vegetative states, showing brain activation in areas that previously were not suspected. But that's a bit different from sort of a discrete network theory.
Gotcha. Okay, this has been awesome. I wanted to ask you before we left about your table hockey skills. you're supposed to be pretty skilled at that, right? Is that what you said on your bio?
Skilled? No. I mean, I have a Guinness World Record for the longest table hockey match, but I am dreadfully unskilled. All I'm skilled at is standing there.
Just stamina?
Yeah. We did a 30-hour table hockey marathon, and I lost my match by exactly 900 points. So I scored 336 against 1,236. The guy I was playing against, in fact, ended up not finishing his undergraduate degree on time because he spent so much time at the pub playing table hockey. So he was a hustler. Wow. I was just the guy that had to be there putting up with his bullshit for 30 hours.
That's funny. 30 hours is a long time.
It's a while. Yeah. And under the Guinness rules, you get a 5-minute break for every 60 minutes of time you've completed in the event. And, you know, that ain't much time.
and you play some poker too. Isn't that accurate?
I do. Yeah. I'm actually a big Solve for Y student.
Okay. So that's how we met each other on Twitter through poker, I think. Yeah.
Probably. Yeah. And, of course, now that there's no live poker, I'm back to kind of grinding online tournaments in Stars. It's like I'm partying like it's 2009.
Oh, right. You're in Canada. Yeah. I forgot. Yeah, we can't play on.
Yeah, I can do that.
Yeah, you can do that.
And I don't have to kind of get involved in these sketchy schemes where you convert money to Bitcoin and put it in a wallet, and then you sometimes don't get to see what the river card was.
Like, yeah, or somebody runs a private game and they'll pay you out later or something. Yeah.
Yeah. All kinds of strange. I'm pretty happy to be playing on a site where there's a fairly reliable and stable regulatory environment.
Right. I'm actually going to play on PokerStars Play Money site later this week with some friends. I haven't done that before, but apparently they have a good system where you can set up a private game and invite anybody you want, and then you can just play on there. And
The scam is they sell you play money, which is absolutely insane.
Yeah, though I think you apparently get like 15,000 in play money every 4 hours. You only have to pay if it's above that or something like that, I think.
Oh, okay.
So it's not as bad as it sounded at first. Yeah.
Just don't play nosebleeds, play money.
No, yeah. If you're going to play money, you know, make it smaller stakes, play money.
You might as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Especially if they charge you for the play money.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Well, this has been very interesting and fantastic stuff. And thanks for your research into these interesting areas and doing your part to advance the science of this stuff. It's all very helpful to humanity, it seems. So,
man, I sure hope so. Yeah. One day we'll find out, right?
All right. This has been Dr. Rob Tarswell. Is there any way you'd prefer people to contact you?
Get a hold of me on Twitter, Rob_Tarswell.
Great. All right. Thanks a lot, Rob. All right. Bye.
You bet. Bye-bye.